In this video, we get quantitative with the induced EMF that occurs when the flux through a loop changes. We start by quantifying magnetic flux, then we state Faraday's law for the size of the induced EMF when the flux changes over a known period of time. So in the picture, we have magnetic field lines penetrating a loop, and flux is really a way of talking about how many field lines we've captured in the loop. Note that it matters which direction they're going through the loop, so we use a normal vector, that's this green vector labeled as n hat. We use a normal vector to orient the surface. And in this case, field lines are passing through the loop almost in the same direction as the normal vector, but there's an angle of theta between them. Now, if theta was zero, then the field would be perpendicular to the face of the loop, and we will maximize our flux. If theta is 90 degrees, that means the face is actually parallel to the magnetic field lines and we'll get zero flux. So we set out to quantify the magnetic flux and we think about the following proportionalities. First, we expect that magnetic flux should be proportional to the field strength. So if I doubled the intensity of the magnetic field, it would double the flux. We're going to use the symbol capital phi for flux. And I'm saying phi is proportional to B. Second, flux should be proportional to area. If I doubled the area captured in a loop and kept the magnetic field the same, then of course we'd capture twice the magnetic field lines. And third, flux should be proportional to the cosine of that angle theta. When that angle theta is zero, the normal vector points in the same direction as the magnetic field. In other words, the surface is perpendicular to the magnetic field lines and will capture the maximum amount of field lines. If we put these three proportionalities together, we get the correct definition for magnetic flux. Next, we introduce Faraday's law, quantifying the induced EMF when the flux changes. Recall from Lenz's law that the basic idea here is that the loop will oppose any change in flux by inducing or attempting to induce a current that creates field lines through the loop in a direction opposing the change. For example, if the initial magnetic field was zero through the loop and you suddenly turned a magnetic field on, the loop will generate magnetic field lines in the opposite direction to try to keep it at zero. Conversely, if you originally have a magnetic field through the loop and you turn it off, a current will be induced in the loop to try to sustain that original direction of flux. You can summarize this by saying nature abhors a change in flux. In other words, the loop's going to try to do whatever it can to keep the flux through it exactly the same. And again, that will be an induced current if the circuit is complete. If you have a loop where it's disconnected and current can't flow, you'll still see an induced EMF that's trying to make current flow in that direction. So exactly how large is this induced EMF? That's Faraday's law. And to quickly motivate Faraday's law, we're going to look at a few proportionalities, just like we did for the definition of flux. First, the induced EMF should be proportional to the change in flux. If I have a bigger change in flux, then of course it's going to create a bigger EMF to try to counteract that change. Second, the induced EMF is going to be inversely proportional to the time it takes to change that flux. So if you were to change the flux very, very slowly, it would take a very, very small current in order to oppose the change in flux. A very fast change in flux is going to require a large EMF and a large current to counteract the change. So I hope that makes sense intuitively. And third, the induced EMF is going to be proportional to how many turns there are in the loop. So now we're generalizing to the possibility that our loop has many, many turns in it and not just one single coil of wire. So if I double the number of turns in a coil, that doubles the flux just because I have twice as many loops catching field lines. And so, of course, if I change the flux, I'm going to get twice the EMF induced. And so we arrive at Faraday's law, and there's a minus sign in this just indicating that Lenz's law direction, that the induced EMF will be acting in a direction that fights the change in flux. Okay, so now we know how to calculate magnetic flux, and we know how to calculate the induced EMF if we change the flux through a loop. Let's wrap things up with a simple example. So in this example, I have a coil of wire that has actually 200 turns in it, and I have the wire disconnected at its ends. So these I refer to in the problem as the terminals of the coil. And we're suddenly switching on a 1 Tesla magnetic field through this thing. The process of turning on that field takes 0.1 seconds. It's totally perpendicular to the face of the coil, so I don't have to worry about the cosine of theta here. Theta is going to be zero, so my flux is maximized and my change in flux is maximized. with respect to the angle. And I have 200 turns in this coil. I'm given a coil diameter of 20 centimeters. I'm asked first to get the average induced EMF across the terminals. So again, current is not actually going to be able to flow here, but I'll still see an induced voltage across the terminals that's attempting to get the current flowing in the direction that opposes the change in flux. And then I said in the second part, if the terminals are bridged with a wire and the coil has a total resistance of 8 ohms, give me the average current that would flow through the coil. All right, so let's start by actually computing the new flux through the coil after the field has been turned on. Again, that's AB cosine of theta, where theta is the angle between the normal vector and the magnetic field. That angle is 0, so the cosine is 1. So I need the area of the loop. That's pi r squared, or you could call it 1/4 pi d squared, either way. I'm going to go ahead and find radius in this case. That's 10 centimeters. And the magnetic field was just 1 tesla. So I get 0.0314 tesla meters squared for the final flux. And of course, the initial was 0 because the magnetic field was off initially. Then we apply Faraday's law. And we say E induced. We don't really care about the minus sign here, but I'll put it in at first. It's going to be negative N delta phi delta T. Again, the minus sign just indicates the direction of this. The induced EMF is going to try to produce a current that opposes the change in flux through the loop. And we have 200 turns, so capital N is 200. My change in flux, it started at 0 and ended at 0.0314. So my change in flux is 0.0314. And the time it took is 1/10 of a second. So I get negative 62.8 volts for this EMF. Again, the minus sign just indicating the direction. It's just as correct in this case to just say, okay, my induced EMF is 62.8 volts. And we can agree the direction is given by Lenz's law. All right, so next I tell you that the total resistance of the wire in this coil is 8 ohms. And I know that over this 0.1 second period, I have this average induced voltage of 62.8 volts. So I should be able to get the current induced in the loop. That's given by Ohm's law, I equals V over R, 62.8 volts over 8 ohms. And this gives me 7.85 amps.